In this video, we're going to be learning water drop photography using the AdaptiLux Studio and the Pluto Trigger, so stick around. Hi guys, I'm Ben from AdaptiLux, and as you've just heard, today we're looking at water drop photography. Now, I'm really excited to be finally trying this out because now we have flash lighting arms. If you didn't see Sam's announcement video, go and check that out because it's really exciting news. We're bringing flash to the AdaptiLux Studio. As many of you will already know, the AdaptiLux Studio until now has always used LED continuous lighting as opposed to flash. What that means is the light is on all of the time and there's no bright, quick flash to freeze the subject. Now, that doesn't mean that it's impossible to get water drop photos. We've done it before using a lot of lighting arms, a lot of light, and really fast shutter speeds. However, flash makes it a lot easier. So we're going to be plugging in our flash arms and trying them out. This is the first time that I've been able to use them since Sam has finished off the prototypes. So I'm really excited to find out what they can do. The other new piece of equipment that I've got to try out is the Pluto Trigger. Now, this is basically just a trigger for your camera, but a really advanced one. It's just this little box which is full of sensors like light sensors, sound sensors, and it's also got Bluetooth capability to link to your phone so you can program it to do all sorts of really interesting and powerful things. What we're going to be using it for today, though, is to trigger a water drop kit, which you can also buy from Pluto, and it all works together seamlessly to create really interesting images of water droplets colliding in mid-air. With all of that said, let's take a look at the other equipment that you're going to need to create these amazing images. So we've got quite a lot of stuff to get through here. To begin with, we've got the Pluto Trigger here, which comes with a Canon adapter here. So I'm going to be shooting on my old Canon 5D, which I've got sat on a mini tripod. And I've got a 100mm f2.8 Tamron lens on the front of there, so we can get nice and close to these water splashes. I've also got the Pluto Valve, which is where we're going to be putting our reservoir of water, and then this little device down here drops it out of the end, controlled via this wire by the Pluto Trigger. Over here we've got our brand new AdaptiLux flash lighting arms. These are the prototypes, and we have the IR blaster as well, and then we have a little color filter as well, which I'm going to try out on these water drops. We've then got the AdaptiLux control pod on another mini tripod, and then we've got our setup for how we're going to drop our water. So I've got two bowls here, simply so I can fill up this top one, and when it overflows, it just goes down into the bottom one. It's going to save us a little bit of tidying up. And then I've got a retort stand over here, which are really cheap online, mostly for chemistry and things like that, but it's going to be really great with this clamp to hold our drop valve here, so we can set all of this up and let's see what it looks like. Let's see how it all works together. I'm aware that I've been talking for quite a while now, so we will get onto some shooting very soon, but this setup is really important and it's a little bit more complicated than the kinds of setups that I would normally use. There's a lot of moving parts to put together. I've got my retort stand up here with the drop valve sat on there, which is now full of water. The reservoir in the top there, you just fill it up and then you can use this little test button to drop water down and make sure that it's right above where you want your water to be hitting, which is these bowls. I've got my middle bowl filled up with water right to the brim so that there's very little of the edges of the bowl visible in the shot. You can look right across that surface of the water and not see the backside of the bowl. The placement of your camera is really important in that regard. The lower down it is, the taller your water drops will seem, but the higher up it is, the more of the ripples you'll see at the surface of the water. Over here I've got my IR emitter sat on top of the camera hot shoe, and that's going to send an IR pulse to the Adaptalux flash lighting arm, which is over here. And the joy of this is that you can place this flash wherever you want it to be. And I encourage you to experiment with the placement of your lighting in as you go through all of your water drops. There's lots of different methods to where you can place your lighting. I see a lot of people reflecting it off the background, so we'll try that and get some silhouettes of the water drops against our white background. You can also place it down here, right next to your water drop, so it's shooting the light across and lighting it from only one side. And you can also place it up from the top and get more highlights on the sort of the mushroom shaped explosions that these water droplets are going to create when they collide with one another. So I'll be moving my lighting around quite a lot and finding the most sort of pleasing spots for our flash to go off in. The final piece of this puzzle, and the thing that ties it all together, is the Pluto trigger just here, which is plugged into the camera, and it's also plugged into the drop valve up here. It's also going to be connected to my phone, and that's how we're going to trigger this whole system to go off. When the Pluto trigger gets the signal from the phone, I'll just be pressing one button on my phone to let the whole thing go off. It'll send a signal up to the drop valve, which will be timed to take the picture with the camera at the same time. So it's sending two signals, one to the drop valve, one to the camera. The camera is then going to trigger the IR trigger on the top to send a signal to the flash lighting arm, all in time with the drops colliding. It's all really rather clever, and I'm really excited to give it a go. I understand that there is quite a lot of trial and error and patience involved, so I'm gonna get my phone out and have a look at the settings on there, change the settings on my lighting arm as well via the Adaptalux app, and see if we can't get some water drops colliding in midair. So here we are in the Adaptalux app. I've connected this to the control pod so that we can change our lighting. You can see that the pod knows that we've only got one flash lighting arm plugged in, and it's set to 50%. What we need to do is bring the speed of this light up all of the way so that it's a really fast flash and it can freeze the motion of our droplets. So what I'm going to do is just select that lighting arm and then slide this all the way up to 100%, which is the fastest setting, and that's represented on the flash lighting arm by 5 lights. Once that's set, we can then head over to the Pluto Trigger app, which is also connected via Bluetooth to the Pluto Trigger. And you'll see here that we have lots and lots of options on how to trigger our camera, including sound. So if you make a loud sound, it'll trigger, or lightning, so you can point your camera towards the sky, and when the lightning goes off, your camera will trigger. But the one that we're interested in today is droplet mode. So you'll see that brings up a lot of timings. If we just hit play right now, the valve released a single droplet, the camera triggered, the flash triggered, and we captured an image that was pretty white, actually. So what I'm going to do before I do anything else is I'm going to focus and I'm going to remove my backdrop, because I want to be able to actually see this droplet go off as I change all of these settings. Firstly, I'm taking away our backdrop so that we've got a clear view, and it will be quite dark in the background there, which will provide a nice contrast between the background and our water droplet. The next thing we need to do is focus. So I know our water drops are landing about here. I can test it and get a good idea of exactly where those drops are landing. And then I'm going to grab a knife, just because I'm in the kitchen, you can use a pen or a straw or anything that's quite long and has some detail to focus on. And you want to press that down into your bowl in the exact position that your water drops are falling. So I've got that about there. And then you can have a look through the back of your camera and focus on your knife exactly where your water drops are going to be falling. So I'm going to do that now, and then we can get back to our settings. So now that we've got our drops in focus and we've got rid of our backdrop so we can see the nice contrast between the backdrop and the drops, we can actually see where our drops are landing. We can set our settings and then we can take a closer look at our lighting and our backdrop again. As we're standing now, we are getting some drops in the shot. I just want to experiment with this flash delay one to see if we can't get them absolutely perfect and exactly where we want them to be. I've turned off the second drop here just so that we can get exactly right on that first drop. Now you can see here that the consistency is pretty good. I mean, we're getting a drop every single time. But I'm wondering what happens if we go a little bit later, maybe to 210, so the flash will trigger a little bit later. Yeah, so we're getting some water in the air there. It's still not jumping up as high as I'd like, so maybe 220. There we go, we've got some drops up in the air. We're still going back down to splashes occasionally, and this is the name of the game, is changing these settings to get them exactly where you want them to be. So maybe 220 with a 30 drop size will do something. The drop size is going to tell you how much water is actually being dropped out of the valve, so that one looks pretty good there. The next thing to think about is your second drop. As that comes down, it's going to, or you want it to, collide with the first one at the peak of its jump after it hits the water. So I'm going to start this one maybe 100 milliseconds afterwards and a drop size of, say, 20. 28 is fine, but 20. And I'm just going to see what that does. Okay, so there wasn't a second drop in that one as far as I can tell. And that one was a little bit late. Again, a little bit late. So you need to play around with these settings. All your settings will be completely different to mine. It's dependent on how high from the ground you're using your dropper. That distance that it takes is going to affect this flash delay. The higher up you have your dropper, the more distance it has to travel, and the longer delay you're going to need between your flash the dropper going off and your flash going off. So I'm going to keep playing around with this and see if I can't get a droplet to collide. I've managed to find the perfect settings for colliding these water droplets in the right spot for my camera. Now the settings that I ended up with, they'll be completely different for you and your setup, but 220 milliseconds for the first drop with a drop size of 20, and then 120 milliseconds for the second drop with, again, a drop size of 20. You can tweak these as much as you like to get the perfect shot for you, but I found that this was pretty consistent. And once you do find your sweet spot of your settings, it is pretty consistent. Every time you take a picture, it will collide and you're getting really nice collisions one after another after another. So the patience to find the settings pays off in the end when you can then go ahead and tweak your lighting, bring your backdrop back in, change your composition with your camera. And once those drops are colliding, it doesn't really matter what you do with your camera or your lighting, they're going to collide in the same place and you can get really creative. The next thing I'm going to do is change the liquid that I'm using to drop, because that's going to again change the look of our droplets. I'm going to be putting milk up in the top reservoir. I'll keep water down in the bottom. It'll eventually get contaminated with milk, but I think that's going to create some really interesting effects on our droplets, because the milk is actually slightly more viscous than the water. It'll hold together a little bit better, and when those sort of mushroom clouds appear on the top of the collision, it might stick together a little bit better and create some nice smooth effects as the water, or as the milk spreads out. So I'm going to keep moving my lighting around. I'm going to put a color filter on here as well and try that out. Move my backdrop in and out and see if I can't get some really cool water drops. During this process, I've managed to get water and now milk pretty much everywhere, all over the kitchen, emptying the bowls out over and over again as they fill up, spilling it all over the floor. Make sure you have some towels around to clear up spillages and all of those splashes. They do jump quite far, so don't expect to stay dry whilst you're doing this. Having said that though, I have had a lot of fun. I've been doing this for hours and hours now. I've taken thousands of images just to really hone in on those collisions. Most of those were duds, but once you find that sweet spot, it's really, really fun, and you can take image after image, play around with your lighting, moving it around to the back, and even shooting it down into the bowl itself. Because this was a white bowl, it acted as a reflector to shoot the light back up underneath those sort of umbrellas where the water is colliding, or the milk is colliding. The milk was a really good call, by the way. I'd recommend trying out at least a little bit of milk, maybe with some food coloring as well. That's what I'll be doing next time that I try this out. The color filters that fit onto the ends of the arms are really effective at adding a little bit of color into your images. I actually really liked the contrast between the white milk and the black backgrounds that we were using quite a lot of the time, but adding a little bit of color is always nice. Now, the flash lighting arms are going to be available very soon. If you're watching this video in the future, they might already be available. Either way, check out the links in the description if you want to find out a little bit more about these flash lighting arms. Now that we've finally got flash with the AdaptLux Studio and I've got some prototypes to play with, I've got a lot of ideas for future videos where I can try out different subjects and different techniques using the flash lighting arms. Make sure to go and subscribe if you want to see those videos, and if you enjoyed this one, give it a like whilst you're down there. If you have specific requests on things that you'd like to see us try out in the future, make sure to put them down in the comments of the video. For now though, guys, thank you very much for watching, and I'll see you next time.